When we think of Intel, we tend to think about it as being one of the most successful CPU manufacturers there is, its CPU architecture being the core of the PC. But Intel has made some mistakes, like the floating point bug in the very first Pentiums, or its recent security problems like Meltdown and Spectre. None of Intel's other mistakes can hold a candle to this one, however. No failure has cost Intel so much or been so public at the time, and luckily for Intel, so well forgotten by the wider public. Even though they're still living with the consequences of this mistake for at least another year or two. Yep, I'm talking about the Itanium. If you're around at the time, you'll remember all the hype about Itanium. About how powerful it was going to be, how it was going to become the next PC architecture. Then you would have got to see just how fast it failed, and how quickly it got the nickname Titanic, and then apparently was gone. You may have wondered how a hugely successful company like Intel got it quite so wrong. Well, stick around, it's time to have a look at the Titanic history of the Itanium. The history of Itanium starts not with Intel, but with these guys, HP. At this point in time, HP not only made PCs, but it also made high-end Unix workstations and eye-wateringly expensive enterprise systems as well. The CPU that powered these systems was HP's RISC PA, which HP had been developing for quite a while. But HP were fast approaching what they thought would be the limit for RISC PA, and that was being able to run one CPU instruction per clock cycle. So HP were looking to try and get more out of a CPU, and the idea they had was epic. By that I don't mean that it was great, I mean that it was explicitly parallel instruction computing. Yeah, epic for short. The idea behind epic was that a compiler could work out which instructions in the program could be run at the same time as each other. It could then at compile time bundle up all the operations that could be run at once into one epic instruction. When it came time to execute the program, the CPU would take each epic instruction and run all the sub-instructions at the same time. In theory, this meant it could greatly increase the amount of work the CPU could do with each clock cycle. This would also get rid of all the complex hardware in a CPU that has to deal with optimizing CPU instructions in the pipeline, like branch predicting and stuff like that. This could now all be made the compiler's problem, which the hardware engineers saw as a win-win. The only problem HP saw with this was it's damn expensive to develop a new CPU architecture. But HP had a good working relationship with Intel, as unlike most other vendors in this space, they were making quite a lot of money from PC sales. So a deal was struck with Intel, HP would move its Unix OS, HP UX, from RISC PA to this new CPU architecture, meaning lots of high-end system sales, and Intel, well, they would develop the CPU and be able to sell it to other customers as well. Everyone's a winner, or at least so they thought. Now the only big thing HP wanted from Intel was a guaranteed roadmap for future CPU development. After all, Unix systems were HP's cash cow, so they were going to need to depend on Intel for the CPU. They needed a guarantee that Intel was going to keep developing it. And like that bit in fairy tales where you all think, why did you agree to that? Intel agreed to that. I mean, they thought they were going to make money out of this thing. And it would in no way come back to bite them in the ass. Yep, it wouldn't matter how many times Intel yelled Rumpelstiltskin, they were stuck with developing this thing. Now Intel were really keen on developing this thing. Because at this point in time, Intel was shut out of the high-end market. Sure, the PC was doing really well, but the high-end expensive stuff? Well, that was all sewn up by HP with its RISC PA, DEC with its VAX platform, Sun had Spark, and SGI with MIPS, and IBM even had its power architecture. So Intel getting into the market replacing RISC PA meant big money to Intel. Development of Itanium took a while, but this worked out well for Intel, as the high-end market was changing fast. First DEC had run into some really big problems. Its longest running line of machines, the PDP range, well, that had finally come to an end. And its successful VAX system, well, that was not problem free either. The VAX platform itself had got pretty aged, and their first attempt to replace the CPU, Prism, well, that had been scrapped, and its next replacement, Alpha, well, it was starting to do well, but it cost an absolute fortune to develop. DEC had lost way too much money and was purchased by Compaq, which at the time was a fairly big shock, as DEC had been the second largest company in the market, second only to IBM, and it just got purchased by a PC manufacturer. However, Compaq was soon in trouble and looking to cut costs, so it decided it would drop the development of the DEC Alpha and move to Itanium for all its big systems, and also shift VAX's OS VMS from Alpha to Itanium. SGI also changed managing director about this point in time to someone who'd been involved in the PC market, and so he decided that he'd move to Itanium. The idea being that this would reduce SGI's development costs as it'd no longer have to spend on MIPS. That decision would prove to be fatal for SGI in the end. If you want to know more about that, you can see my video I've done on SGI, I'll put a link in the description below. Sun, unlike the others, decided it would hold back and it would keep working on its UltraSpark architecture. But it did announce that it would port Solaris to Itanium, which in the end it never actually did. Even the big Unix vendors for the PC platform got behind Itanium, with Project Monterey. Project Monterey brought together all the big Unix vendors of the time, SCO, Sequent, IBM, to work on one Unix variant for Itanium. Now this version never actually did get to the point of being released, and the fallout from that led to SCO suing IBM when it started to contribute code to the Linux kernel. DEC, now owned by Compaq, renamed Digital Unix to True64 and announced it would be moving to Itanium, which of course never happened, because Compaq went bust and then got bought by HP. Unsurprisingly, Microsoft would also port Windows NT to Itanium as well. So, business-wise, Itanium was going well. It had become an extinction-level event for most CPU architectures, killing off both RISC-PA and Alpha, and well, more or less killing off MIPS as well. Then Intel released the first version of the Itanium CPU to developers, and well, this is where it all changes. The performance of it was, well, awful. In Windows NT, it was worse than current x86 CPUs. Linux was the first OS to get running on Itanium, thanks to the efforts of Project Trillion. But again, its performance was, well, disappointing. Big part of the problem was compilers. Intel had been working on their own compiler to help make EPIC instructions a success, but well, it turned out to be much harder than Intel expected, with most compile code being unable to fill an EPIC instruction. The open source compiler GCC did a much better job of getting it done than Intel's own one did, but it was still far from great. The underlying performance of the CPU was also not that great either. Intel released a second version, which was meant for mass production, and it was, you know, better, but it was still nowhere near what was needed. Interest in Itanium started to dry up, and projects to port Solaris and Monterey quietly shutting down. However, Windows NT was released for it, and Linux, HPUX, SGI Xyrix, and of course VMS, the OS from the VAX system. With Itanium floundering, no one was talking about it as the future of PCs anymore. In fact, it felt like Itanium was in limbo, and then came the hammer blow from AMD. Yep, AMD produced AMD 64, a 64-bit version of the x86 instruction set. And unfortunately for Intel, yeah, that thing performed. It performed really well running 32-bit code. It performed really well running 64-bit code. Something that the Itanium, well, couldn't do. Yep, suddenly AMD would become the future of the PC, and Itanium just wouldn't be. Server vendors Sun and IBM soon started AMD 64 offerings, and they were selling well, as they could run 32-bit code much faster than Itanium, and, you know, a little bit better than Intel's own x86 chips, and of course, they could run 64-bit code. This was Intel's worst nightmare. AMD was still squeezing it at the low end of the market, and it looked like they could wipe them out in the high end. So, under pressure from Microsoft, who wanted to drop Itanium, with their market share at risk from AMD, Intel agreed to license AMD 64's instruction set, with everyone agreeing to call it x86-64 from now on. This whole thing had been a financial disaster for Intel. I'll show you the now infamous graph of Intel's expected earnings from Itanium, and of course its actual earnings. Yikes. It's at this point in time that everyone assumed Itanium was dead, and everyone had just stopped talking about it. However, remember that deal with HP? That cursed fairy tale deal? Well, that meant as long as HP kept buying CPUs, Intel had to keep to the roadmap. So for the last 20 years, Intel has had to keep paying to develop Itanium. Still had to keep making them, and will do for a year or two more. It's only this year that Linus Torvald announced that Linux will be dropping support for it. So you may be wondering what this zombie architecture's been doing for the last 20 years. The answer is running expensive HP servers. Yep, it's still being used to run VMS, which finally got ported to x86-64, only in the last year or two. And of course, it's still running HPUX as well. This is the part of the video where I'd normally start showing you around some bit of kit, but not this time. You can still buy an Itanium server secondhand, but well, they're still over a grand, and that's far too much to spend on what would essentially just be a prop for one video. More or less anything I could show you running on Itanium would be, well, more fun to show you running on another piece of kit. Wanna see VMS running? Well, that's more interesting on an Alpha. Wanna see HPUX running? Well, again, it's far more iconic on RISC-PA. If you wanna see Xyrix, yeah, you're gonna wanna see that on a real MIPS bit of SGI kit. Itanium's just not a fun platform, and most Itanium servers are huge, and well, who wants to use that much storage space on Itanium? I mean, I can fit a few more Amigas in that space. Or an SGI box or two. Hell, even a Sun server. So that's more or less it for Itanium. except for to mention the one bit of the former future PC that made it into the actual PC. When Intel were creating Itanium, they needed a new boot firmware, as the PC's BIOS was riddled with limitations from 80s computers, so they created EFI to boot Itanium machines. Years later, when they were trying to modernize the PC, Intel brought EFI back and put a U in front of it, giving us UEFI, the firmware used by most PCs to boot today. Well, when it's not just running in BIOS emulation mode, that is. If you made it to the end, I hope you found today's journey through Intel's most costly mistake today interesting. If you think others will be interested, please like and share and whatnot. Also, if you'd like to help the channel out, you could subscribe and gently nudge that little bell thing, as it really helps little channels like this one.